This is No Spin Live special edition, and we're going to be talking about online misnomers on breast implants. We've got an incredible panel of international experts here, starting with Dr. Pat McGuire from St. Louis, Dr. Mindy Hawes from Nashville, Tennessee, Dr. Caroline Glicksman from Seagirt, New Jersey, and the person who traveled the furthest, Dr. Anand Deva from Sydney, Australia. Hope everybody's doing well, and I know all of you have been very busy, especially with the Allergan recall. We've seen, obviously, the FDA with this worldwide recall of Biocell recommend that women who are asymptomatic and have a Biocell implant should not have it removed. But we all know that we're seeing women in their practices that are asymptomatic, but they're worried or they want to have their implants changed out. And there's been a lot of confusion online, particularly for patients, about things like on-block capsulectomy, sending their capsules for CD30, some other misnomers are out there. And luckily, Dr. Pat McGuire led a team of esteemed people to write a paper on this. And so I thought, Pat, we'd start with that. You know, maybe what do you think the most important things patients need to know and be educated on?
Yeah, on July 24th, Allergan issued a voluntary recall of their Biocell textured implants. And after that, I got a lot of questions from surgeons and from patients about it. That's why the esteemed group is everybody who was on this call. And because a lot of surgeons didn't know what to do or what to tell their patients about, you know, do they need their implants removed? Do they need the capsules removed? And the first thing is that the FDA has not recommended anyone have their implants removed if they are not having issues. But we are seeing women who are, you know, I'm worried about this. I don't, you know, I feel like I'm a ticking time bomb and I would like to have my implants removed. So the first big question I have gotten is, if we remove the implants, do we need to remove the capsule? And there really isn't any long-term studies on this. And ALCL is so rare, I tell my patients there's a 99.9% chance you will not get ALCL if you have a Biocell implant. So with that low rate, we don't know whether leaving a capsule or not leaving a capsule will make a difference. So looking at what we could find and knowing that there have been patients who have been diagnosed with ALCL without textured implants with a history of a previous smooth. There have been patients who've had implants removed with a capsule left in place, and those patients developed ALCL. But if you look at those cases, they all had symptoms at the time of their implant removal. So that's a very different patient than the asymptomatic patient. But our consensus was that if a patient is concerned enough about ALCL to have their implants removed, and we know the capsule is where the ALCL seems to develop or form, then our recommendation was that if safely done, the capsule probably should be removed at the time of capsulectomy.
Mindy, what are you seeing from your patients, and what kind of things would you like to clear up?
I think the biggest thing is what Pat hit, which is that this is not a recall like we see with our cars. You don't bring it in, you don't have to get it fixed or else your airbag's gonna explode. Your implants, as Pat said, you got a 99.9% chance of not having a problem. That being said, if you're uncomfortable with that added risk, or if it's been 10 or 15 years, or for any other reason you're ready to change out implants, then we can go ahead and proceed. The question then becomes, as Pat talked about, with the asymptomatic patient, you don't need to remove the implants. So if you go in, if you can remove the capsule, great. If you can't, or it's wispy thin, I talk with the patients, that's plus minus. I'd like to get it out if I can. But what now I'm seeing with patients is they're coming in with, I've not seen them in years, and they've got these terrible capsular contractures, but now that there's a recall, now they think they should have them treated. So I'm seeing patients who are actually taking more ownership of their implants, that this was the thing that finally made them come in and talk about what can or shouldn't be done.
Anand, so, you know, Australia, obviously slightly different regulatory body than we have in the U.S., but this was a global recall of Biocell, so it certainly affected, I think, you guys, just because of the CE mark, actually didn't have Biocell for even prior to it happening in the U.S., but kind of what are you seeing and what are your thoughts on some of this?
Well, I think the Australian perspective is really interesting in that we're actually in the process right now of our regulator making a final decision. And unlike in the US and more like in Europe, we have a variety of different textures on the market. So we're seeing women obviously worried about a biocell recall, but also women then worried about just textured implants overall. In Australia, you know, for around 20 years or more, 90%, 95% of implants going into our women have been textured implants. It's a very different situation here. And of course, it's the same concerns that Pat and Mindy have spoken about. People pick up the newspaper or watch TV and they go, oh my God, this thing's in me, what do I do? There is a lot of confusion, I agree, on the language of a medical recall. It's not a kind of automotive recall or a product recall. Medical recalls come in all different grades, and this particular one is just a removal of product from the shelves or in the warehouse or in the distribution centre or in the doctor's office. It's not removal from patients. So, you know, our job as surgeons is to balance risk and benefit. You know, we do that all the time. If someone comes to us with a problem, we have to advise them about, well, this operation carries X risk, but it can give you this benefit. And so you've got to separate out patients who have no problem. So in other words, clinically a normal examination, radiologically nothing on ultrasound or MRI or PET scan or CT scan, and reassure them. So my advice, strong advice to these women, and I know they're anxious, of course, understandably, is to say, well, here's your opportunity for us to keep a really close eye on you. Yes, you're at risk. The risk probably stands around 1 in 2,000 or so. So it's not a huge risk compared to other risks in medicine. But come every 6 months, you know. If you wake up one morning and you're worried, come back in. I'll see you 100 times a year if you like. But I can't justify subjecting you to a risk of an operation at this point. And as Mindy said, you know, performing a capsulectomy or a complete capsulectomy on some of these women is probably the only way that you can absolutely reduce the risk of ALCL. Not a great operation to be doing a complete capsulectomy, particularly in a normal capsule, because you're into very flimsy tissue on the chest wall and up in the axilla. And in fact, the risk of causing a harm or significant damage certainly outweighs the benefits.
So, Anand, just briefly on, I mean, you and your colleagues in Australia probably have the best data and paper on stratification of risk for different textures. So where are you on that? Because you guys have shown nicely the more texture carries a lot higher risk. So can you update us on that?
So the language around texture has to change. We published a paper, actually you're on the paper, Bill, looking at what sort of surfaces implants have. And in the US, it's a bit binary. It's like you've got maybe two or three brands of texture. At the rest of the world, there's such a variety of different devices. And so rather than use descriptive terms like nano, micro, macro, we've tried to introduce language of a numeric scale. So the scale starts at level 4, which is the highest surface area and roughness. These are actual measurements we can do in the laboratory. And we create a number. So the grade 4s essentially correspond to what's called a polyurethane covered implant. They carry at the moment, at least in Australia, the highest known risk of ALCL, around about 1 in 2,000, slightly less. That's the latest number. And then you have a grade 3 device, which in the main is the biocell type device. I'm saying a biocell type device because other companies use a similar manufacturing technique. And the grade 3 devices are sitting somewhere around 1 in 2 to 3,000, so a little bit less than the grade 4s. And then the big jump is when you go to a grade 2 device. Now, these textures are much gentler. They've got a lower surface area and, interestingly, a very low roughness as well. And those carry a published risk of around 1 in 80,000. So there's a huge jump. And then, of course, the grade 1 devices are smooth devices. And as we've said, there's no known case that we know of to date where a woman's developed ALCL from exposure to a grade 1 device. So it gives us a really good framework in order to think about, A, explaining to patients what the risk of ALCL is, but also then in decision-making. You know, we do need texture sometimes. And this is what Australian surgeons have been trying to advise our regulator. We need it for difficult cases. If there's a tuberous breast, if there's a reconstruction, there's a very big pocket that you need to try and control. If you need to try and fight gravity, then the texture actually grips the tissue. So texture and shaped implants can be a great advantage. And in the aesthetic patient, of course, trying to obviate the need for a mastopexy and do, you know, put additional scars on patients, we use the anatomic shape very effectively. So let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater, right? Let's not get rid of all texture and actually disadvantage some patients where you and I and all of us struggle to actually achieve a good long-term stable result. So that's kind of where the debate is at the moment. Where it lands, who knows? I mean, I think at times of confusion and trouble, we need data. We need to go back to published studies. We need to do good, robust research. As Pat says, this is a very difficult area because now that this has happened, we really don't have good data to go on in terms of should we do a complete capsulectomy or not. I think we then have to go back to being good doctors, right? Advising our patients, trying to calm their anxiety, offer them an alternative surgery, which I believe would be regular surveillance, reassure them that even, in, heaven forbid, if they were the 1 in 2,000 patient that got the cancer, if they pick it up early, none of these patients essentially need further treatment apart from surgery, and we can reconstruct them with smooth implant. So, you know, let's try and lower the anxiety, let's use logic and being good medical professionals to help guide patients.
Caroline, you know, you've done a lot of work over the years in educating people on informed consent and that whole avenue. So the others have alluded to this, you've got to stratify what the risk and the benefits of the different procedures are. So it's just not cookie cutter. You can't say, everybody should just have surgery because, for example, to put it in perspective, like the micromort of having a general anesthetic is 10. Okay. We know the micromort of having BILCL is 0.5. It's actually far lower to just having a general anesthetic. And we're talking about asymptomatic patients that don't have BILCL. So the risk is much higher. So how do you discuss that with the patient? What do you recommend to patients who are just concerned because they know about this recall?
Well, it's very interesting when you talk about how patients understand risk. There's something called numeracy, and that is their conception, their understanding of what numbers mean. So I tried all different ways. I saw 8 patients today who are coming in from letters. I sent out my own letters, plus the Allergan letters, plus my regular follow-up. So it's getting a bit crazy in my office, but I'm seeing all these patients and basically trying different approaches and saying to them, you have a 1 in 8 chance of breast cancer, which is 12%. You have a 0.003% of this, of ALC, and getting their responses right over their heads. They don't hear any of it. All they hear is, my husband's online, he's making me crazy. Can I get the free implant? And I really just sit with the patients and try to educate them on numbers and risks. Now, some of them are more reasonable, a little bit more intelligent. Some of the patients, and I don't want to belittle patients who aren't very bright, because they can understand risk as well. But you have to put it in terms that they can understand. Your mother had breast cancer, your aunt had breast cancer, you're afraid of cancer in your family, go ahead, take them out. You know, I can't argue with those patients. But for the patients who understand numbers and I can try to relate the real risk, I say to them, you're not getting a bilateral mastectomy and your rate is 12% chance of that. Obviously, you're not taking those bags off of your chest. If your husband's that concerned, take them off. So I basically try to calm the patients down using different methods to educate them. But still, when it comes down to it, if you were to say to them, come back every 6 months and we'll have constant surveillance, like Anand said, I can't physically afford that. I'm not at a university. And I'm seeing, you know, like I said, 8 to 10 patients a day right now. It's a big crash right now of these patients just getting the letters. But I think we have to explain risk to them, risk versus benefit. The other thing I just wanted to mention is, there's a reason I was a textured physician. And I sent Pat McGuire today. I can't tell you how many pictures we sent back and forth today of our 10-year results, 12-year results of complicated chest wall patients, deformed patients, drop dead beautiful at 10 years with a textured implant. And they want to take them out. Well, I tell them your biggest risk is rupture. I mean, we know that implant's going to fail and develop a rupture, and you're going to get a free implant right now, so now is your time to change. But it's very difficult to educate on risk when they just have this set of, I want them out. No elective implant is worth any cancer. And that's kind of what I'm seeing in my office. And I just tell them, you have a higher risk of capsular contracture with a smooth implant. You have a higher risk of malposition with this implant, rippling, visibility, all the things we mitigated with your other implant. You have to consider the aesthetic outcomes as well, because every time we take away one benefit, we're trading it for something else. So all of those risks have to be given to a patient. And I think over maybe multiple interviews and discussions, they'll get it and make up their own minds.
Yeah, interestingly, if you have a BILCL implant, your risk of capsular contracture if we assume capture and contracture rates are, say, 10%, is about 300 times greater your capture and contracture than breast implant ALCL. I want each of you to answer some specific kind of questions that are coming up a lot and a lot of misinformation. So, Pat, starting with you, back to your paper that has defined some of these things. Online, there are a lot of patients that are being advised that they need to, when they, if they are asymptomatic, saying they're having, say they decide to have the discussion, they're going to have a capsulectomy, that they need that, they need to send the capsule for CD30. CD30 is a screening immunohistochemistry test that we send for seromas, but now patients are coming in saying, well, I want my capsule sent for CD30. You addressed this in the paper. Can you clarify that for our viewers?
Yeah, it's not just patients, it's physicians who are saying, do I need to send the capsule for CD30? And CD30 is not diagnostic for breast implant-associated ALCL. CD30 is a marker on a lymphocyte, and it is a marker that's present in breast implant-associated ALCL, but it's also present in inflammatory lymphocytes, and that has to be also not just CD30, but atypical lymphocytes. So for a solid capsule, we're sending fluid off. A patient has a seroma, and we draw that up. That we do send for CD30 testing, the lymphocytes that are seen in there. But on a capsule, the pathologist can look at that capsule under the microscope, and if the pathologist does not see abnormal lymphocytes, there's no reason to stain those lymphocytes or do the immunohistochemistry to look specifically for CD30.
I think you just recently wrote about, you know, people that all of a sudden are explantation experts. Tell us a little bit about this, because this is a big problem, and it's not a good thing for patients.
No, look, I feel really strongly about this, and that's why I wrote the opinion piece. I mean, look, you know, at the end of the day, we really should be mindful of how vulnerable some of these patients are. I mean, when you talk about cosmetic breast augmentation, we in Australia have seen the rise of these, sort of basically sausage factory type clinics with very, very shiny upfront marketing to try and lure women into surgery without clear explanation of risk or even a cooling off period to think about it, based on cheap price, you know. So if you lower the price enough, you get enough volume, it would make money. But it doesn't really take into account really sitting with the patient, a young, say 20-year-old woman, and really making her understand that this surgery is not, you know, not without its risks, and also understanding and explaining to these women that this is not going to be the first operation on your breast. I mean, you put an implant in, chances are as you go through child rearing and then as you get older, and as implants get older, you're going to need one, maybe two more operations. So exploiting vulnerable women, I think, is something I feel really strongly about. I don't think as doctors that's our job. So when, of course, the news, and in fact, even before this news was announced, when a lot of research and media was focusing on the issue of ALCL and texture, we started to see business models pretty much parallel the cheap implants going in, sort of arise, and trying to claim ascendancy as an expert on explantation or on this term en bloc, which I absolutely hate when applied to benign disease. So I really think that we as a profession need to look hard at ourselves and the behavior and the ethics and the patient focus, and not take advantage of fear. One thing that's worse than preying on vulnerable people is preying on people that are scared. I mean, at the end of the day, we have to understand that we're doctors first and foremost. We're not business people. We're not salespeople. So when I see websites that are now advertising cheap explant removal, with conditions such as no contracture, no rupture, no complications, I'm like, well, hang on, these are asymptomatic patients, and they're trying to lure them in for unnecessary and risky surgery. So, you know, like all these things, they teach you a little bit about some of our colleagues in terms of their motivations and their behavior. And I think it's up to us as leaders in the profession to say, look, that's not right. We shouldn't be preying on patients.
Caroline, so, you know, like the online era, the internet, all this, it's probably great if you want to order a pizza. It's great if you want Uber Eats. That's good. But it's actually been, I think, a negative thing for medicine, because people spread, it's very easy to spread misinformation. So one of the things Anant mentioned, I just wanted you to talk more specifically about, is this whole concept of en bloc capsulectomy, because there's a lot of actually marketing about, there's only a few people around the country that are able to do that. it's indicated in various procedures that there's no data to support. So can you just speak to that specifically?
Yeah, I mean, I basically, again, what Anand said, I spend the time with my patient educating them on the risks versus the benefits. I have a teaching model that I utilize. It just shows them basically on the chest wall. And I have pictures of patients with capsules that, as Pat would call them, are like wet toilet paper. You know, it's just tissue paper thin. And basically showing them what different capsules can look like. That this word en bloc is from when I was at Sloan Kettering and we removed tumor and cancer. And that this whole concept is basically a snake oil, making money quick type of a scheme, and that Dr. Google is not going to predict what kind of surgery I'm going to do on my patients, and that basically the safest surgery is what I'm going to look for. If I see something abnormal, I remove something abnormal, as I have for almost 30 years. I'm not changing my practice with these patients, but they have to understand they can't come in and ask for something that's not medically safe or scientifically sound. And so it's just basically, most of the time, the patients are reasonable. I find it's mothers, sisters, husbands who are putting fear into these patients, and somebody is constantly online. Somebody in that focus, a patient's daughter, their niece, their sister, somebody is feeding them. And it is that concept of that cyberbullying. You know, these women are being told this is what they need to do. Go in with a list and tell your doctor this is what you need. And we with the ALCL group, I think these women are much more reasonable. There's other groups out there that may be not so reasonable. But I think that you have to sit with those patients and describe to them what's happening in the operating room, because I don't think they have a clue. They just think this is what they see. The doctor in California is booked out till next February, and I need to get this operation, and I won't do it unless it's indicated. So I think each of us are just sitting there, and like Anand said, we're doctors first, and I'm not going to hurt somebody because they come in with what they were told to do online. And I think you can each comment on that as well.
Yeah, Mindy, you know, I want you to comment, and also, you know, you're leading a number of task force committees for the Aesthetic Society, because not only are patients sometimes have some misinformation, but even physicians can have misinformation or not have the information that they want. So maybe you can speak a little bit towards some of the efforts that you're making towards providing the plastic surgeons with the proper information.
You know, kind of, Caroline was talking about this with the way she informs patients and the way she educates patients and how you have to meet each patient where they are. And we're seeing this more and more with breast implants, but it's with all types of consent for all surgery we do. So one of the task force that I'm heading up is the Informed Consent Task Force. And certainly our informed consent has to change around breast implants, because breast implant-associated anaplastic large cell lymphoma is a real entity that has been on the rise and now has caused a recall. So it's something that needs to be included in our informed consent. But all of our informed consent can't just be the old standard 14 pages, check every paragraph and initial at the bottom of each page. We need to be more involved with our patients in that. And they need to be able to kind of teach back to us what they did learn. And like with Caroline's example of numeracy, it has to be in their language, whether it's video, whether it's verbal, whether it's written. So that's one of the task force we're working with. The other one is the Breast Implant Illness Task Force, which I have found my patients concerned about ALCL aren't talking about en bloc, which are the ones that if they had ALCL should have an en bloc resection. Yet the breast implant illness patients who have thin grade one tissue paper capsules, I took pictures of some the other day where I could read newsprint through the capsule. They're the ones thinking they need an en bloc resection, which again, to Anand's point, is the most dangerous group because their capsules are thin and asymptomatic and you can damage a whole lot of other structures. So the Breast Implant Task Force, we're working to educate our members, not just in what to say, but in how to say it to these patients so that we can communicate better and help try and fight this wave of bad information. When we were at the FDA last spring, Pat and I both met with members of one of the big breast implant illness Facebook groups. And from our talks with them at the FDA, and Pat has kept up with them, they've tried to push out, even in the big groups, that just because a doctor says an en bloc resection isn't possible doesn't mean they're a bad doctor. And that's a big win for us. And it helps with those pandering doctors who are fear-mongering and frightening patients.
Yeah, Nan, go ahead.
I just want to make a quick point. I mean, look, well done on trying to drive change through the societies. I think it's really commendable what you're doing, Mindy. But can I just make one minor suggestion? Instead of talking about informed consent, let's use the words informed educated consent. Because I think education of the patient, as you say, there's various levels of understanding of numbers, risk, etc. So the education, informed educated consent says that consent is not the same for everyone and that you need to be satisfied that you've actually transferred that knowledge and made sure the patient's understood what you said. So we're starting to use that terminology, I think. So you don't have to use it, but I'd suggest that perhaps you use that term.
Yeah, no, I think it's great. Actually, Caroline and I, for many years, have given presentations on, you know, basically patient education, because patient education is intertwined with informed consent. They're not two separate entities, and it's not this notion that informed consent is this little disclosure somebody signs is complete rubbish, because it's actually people, unless they're truly educated, you never have any informed consent. So it takes time. It's actually not just the doctor. It takes a whole team in the medical practice, as well as a patient that's willing to assimilate that information. So the patient has responsibility in that too. All right, well, great stuff. We're going to get some just quick closing remarks from our experts. So, Pat, why don't you lead off?
Yeah, I think one of the points Caroline made earlier is important. We're seeing some of our textured implant patients back 10 years, 12 years out. And a lot of the patients are saying, well, why would you even have used these textured implants if they're associated with a cancer? Well, there are benefits to them. You know, when I see these patients 10 years, 12 years, I've seen patients 15, 20 years out that still have great results. We see less capsular contracture. The position remains stable on these patients, and they look very good. So when I'm seeing them back, I'm reminded why I use them. I changed over to smooth implants 3 years ago when the numbers were climbing up on the risk of ALCL. But there's a trade-off, and the trade-off are you don't have the same stable results. You don't have some of these complicated breast reconstructions and cosmetic asymmetries. We can't get the same results with a smooth implant. And I think there are reasons the implants were used. And I think patients need to understand that there was thought that went into using them in the first place.
I think a lot of what we're going through, and we will go through, I suspect, for months ahead, boils down to trust. You know, so there's a growing trust deficit with some of these patients. They don't trust the companies. They don't trust the FDA. They don't trust the clinicians. They don't trust the news. They're misplacing their trust in, you know, a few people that, are, as you say, are pandering to fear, uncertainty. And so I think it's our job to reestablish trust with, you know, all these groups of patients, whether they're BII, ALCL, or whatever patient that has some sort of issue with, of giving the wrong information, the doctor didn't care about me, they just wanted to make money. I think, you know, that language and to build trust is difficult. You know, I think particularly when things have gone wrong. So look, it's a tough job. I'm delighted that, you know, some of us are now standing up as leaders within our profession, that we're being vocal about, you know, being ethical, being patient focused, being very much about informing and educating our patients, and also offering them, you know, ongoing lifetime care. No device lasts forever. So I think there are valuable lessons here. I think we're going to continue to learn, and we're going to continue to face challenges. And I'm really glad to be, you know, part of this and other groups that are trying to drive a better practice.
Mindy, closing remarks?
Tying into what Anand and Pat were saying with building the trust and these patients that come in that I hear over and over again, and I read it online, that doctors are just, they just wanted to make money with implants. They took advantage of me to make money. Yet they don't see that these biggest groups who say that they're the only ones who can do a breast implant removal and do it safely are charging more for that than people ever charge for a primary breast augmentation. And that is going to turn around and going to bite us all really hard, and it's going to cost us trust on that end too. So it's another reason why the fear mongering and that kind of business needs to stop, because it is going to violate trust even more down the line.
Yeah, I think that at the end of the day, the FDA and all regulatory agencies, they look at a risk versus benefit for an elective procedure. And we know for 50 years that you can't document what the benefit is for this type of a procedure other than self-esteem, a quality of life, and the risks, they want to be minimal. And the problem is for all of these women that are unhappy and they're complaining and they want their implants out and their fear, there are young women who are flat-chested, insecure, and are still looking to get breast implants. You haven't stopped that group of patients who want these implants for whatever reason. So again, building trust, you're not stopping the reason that women are getting them. We just have to make it safe, and they have to understand that they have our, you know, we have their backs. And I just think moving forward, you're not going to ever stop women from wanting breast implants. We just have to do it safely.
Great discussion. It's been a great special edition of No Spin Live. And if you want to see more of this, you can see it on theplasticsurgerychannel.com.